This is an ancient Egyptian rat trap. This is a trap from 1894. And this is a smart trap that sends kill alerts to your phone. Despite the thousands of years we've had to build a better rat trap, they're all basically the same. Catch the rat, kill the rat, throw the rat away, and repeat. Even this one from 1882, which is just a revolver. Except now, we have Wi-Fi. Increasing urbanization means more people living in cities and more resources for rats to thrive on. And experts think rising temperatures due to climate change will further increase rat populations. But after doing the same thing for ages, it's time to change the way we think about sharing the cities we both call home. Rats are so successful because they breed fast and are incredibly adaptable. They can have up to 5 litters a year, each with up to 8 pups. That means a pair of rats can produce 40 babies a year, and each of those rats can start having their own babies at just 12 weeks old. That quickly becomes a lot of rats. Good thing they'll eat almost anything. They can survive by sorting through garbage, eating human excrement in sewers, or scavenging leftover birdseed and pet food. If it's edible, rats will eat it. Rats also don't need much space and aren't picky about where they live. Any crack, crevice, or patch of soil is a potential home, and the resident rat family can find all it needs to survive and multiply in the space of a city block or less. So it's not hard to imagine how a city can quickly become filled with rats. And rats can carry bacteria and viruses that make people sick. We still see outbreaks of bubonic plague, even today. And recent cases of leptospirosis and hepatitis E are also linked to rats. But even beyond disease, interactions with rats have detrimental effects on our mental health. They can trigger feelings of fear and anxiety, and even cause us to avoid certain places and lose sleep. How well would you sleep if you heard rats scurrying around your bedroom? So, what can we do? Surely we must be better at managing rats than the ancient Egyptians. It's the 21st century after all. We have spaceships and smartphones and lasers. Today's poisons are much more effective at killing rats, but with new technology comes unintended consequences. A recent study found over 80% of bald eagles had rat poison in their system. Besides, who wants to live in a city covered in poison? In 2017, with all the advantages of modern technology, New York City announced a $32 million plan to reduce the rat population by 70%. But 2 years later, rat sightings were already climbing again in the city. It's not only difficult to kill rats, it's dangerous. Everyone assumes that fewer rats means fewer diseases. This is one of the roots of our obsession with killing rats. Remove rats, remove disease. However, recent research from the Vancouver Rat Project has shown that killing rats has unpredictable impacts on the microbes they carry. In some cases, it can even increase the number of rats carrying disease. Rats live in social structures, just like human families. When you remove some, it might change how frequently and closely rats interact with each other. And this could cause disease to spread. Turns out, managing rats might actually be harder than rocket science. And that's because they're part of a complicated, ever-changing system, one involving people, animals, the environment, economies, infrastructure, policy, politics, and much, much more. No wonder our whack-a-rat mentality doesn't work. It ignores the underlying complexity. To understand that complexity, we need data. How many rats are there? Where do they live? Why are they there? What problems are they causing? Without that data, there's no way to know what strategies we should use or if those strategies are working. Strategies like educating the public about how they can prevent rats, setting up a hotline to report rat sightings, changing bylaws to require that landlords actually deal with rat infestations, or changing to rat-proof garbage cans. You might notice that none of these strategies involve killing rats. Instead, they're the product of urban planning and management. The best strategies are those that increase the overall health and well-being of our communities. For example, you can use the same techniques for rodent-proofing a home as you do for making it more energy efficient. So a single home improvement strategy works for rats, climate change, and your pocketbook. It's not a matter of seek and destroy. It's about being better stewards of our urban environments. And every city is different. What works in Vancouver might not work in New York. Given how quickly our cities are changing, what works now may not work in 10 years. This is why we need strong leadership from local government to start thinking about how to manage our interactions with rats. This starts with investing in smart people and not smart traps. And that's just it. Rats are always going to be our neighbors, so we need to learn to live with them in a way that makes our cities healthier for all of us.